हेलो फ्रेंड्स, गुड मॉर्निंग। कैसे हैं आप लोग सब? माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। सो दीज क्लासेस आर बेसिकली मेंट फॉर दोस हु आर प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन व्हिच इज कंडक्टेड बाय द यूपीएससी। ओके, एंड फॉर दैट यू शुड ऑल्सो स्टडी द नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स लाइक यू वुड बी प्रोबेबली स्टडीइंग दोज नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स लाइक हिंदू और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। You can subscribe our channel on the YouTube also, where you will be getting these lectures on the day-to-day basis, and this will supplement your preparation for your civil services examination. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is about Helmand. Helmand is basically a province in Afghanistan. Okay, it is the restive province. Restive province means there is a continuous fight between the Afghanistan security forces, right, as well as the Taliban to control this Helmand provinces. Okay, this Helmand province is basically having certain benefits of having the control by the Taliban. So Taliban want to control this Helmand provinces. I'll come to that, what are those strategic reasons, right, for which the Taliban is more interested in this Helmand provinces. But right now there was, some ceasefire, 3-day ceasefire that was due to the Eid al-Fitr, so that was the festival the Muslims used to celebrate. Now the ceasefire that was agreed between the Taliban forces as well as the Afghanistan forces have now been breached, and now heavy firing, right, from Taliban side have been seen there, specifically in the Helmand province of Afghanistan. Okay, it is basically the southern province in Afghanistan. The Helmand is also known as the Helmand or Helmand also, right? In the ancient time, it is also known as Hathumand. This province called Helmand province is located basically in the southern Afghanistan. It consisting of, 13 districts. So this province consisting of 13 districts, and area wise, if you consider, it is the largest province. It is the largest province by area. And it is one among the 34 provinces which are there in the Afghanistan. Just like when you can think of the states in India, you have it in every state, you have the districts, right? Just like in the Afghanistan, you have the provinces, and every provinces have certain district. So Helmand province is basically the largest province among 34 provinces in Afghanistan, and Helmand province consisting of 13 districts. All right. So you must also understand that why there is a fighting between the Afghan forces and the Taliban forces. So that thing you must understand, and why this after ceasefire the Taliban basically even started fighting. So the US has already announced that the US is pulling the forces from the Afghanistan, and there is a one base also in the Helmand, or there is a joint base, right, where the NATO forces as well as the US forces is training the Afghan security forces in the Helmand province of Afghanistan. Now this pullback of these forces from the US and the NATO was started just 2 days ago only. Okay, but it is hardly 6% of the withdrawal process. It will take a longer time. But you must also understand that since 2001 onward, when the Taliban basically have attacked the US, right, since then the US accompanied with NATO has invaded Afghanistan, right, and then thereafter the US basically have some control over the Helmand provinces. But the Talibani resurgence or Talibani extremist or Talibani the terrorists are basically having the control in the Afghanistan. So there was a NATO combat mission when almost 20,000 troops from United States and other NATO states have been deployed with the Afghan National Defense Security Forces in the Helmand. And since then, right, the Taliban is continuously fighting with those security forces, including with the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces. Now you must understand there are different benefits why the Taliban is more interested in controlling the Helmand provinces. First of all, in terms of the area, I told you that area wise the Helmand is the largest province in the Afghanistan. Okay. If you consider the size of the Helmand provinces, it is almost twice the size of Belgium, the Belgium in the country. Okay. Second and most important reason the Taliban is interested in the Helmand is that it is also the most fertile provinces in Afghanistan. Okay. Most fertile provinces, and the river Helmand also flows through this provinces, and this province also has the relatively organized canal system. Okay, where the agricultural land opportunities are also there, and climate is also most suitable for, you know, for the cultivation of opium, right? Opium, and almost world 40% of the opium basically grows from this Helmand provinces, and it is also the source of, or the greater source of, the revenue for the Taliban. And in addition to this agricultural tax, right, the marble mine, specifically in the Khanachin district of you know, of this Helmand province, is another financial source for the Taliban, right? So the resources or the tax which are the Taliban is gaining from the agricultural tax, from the mine tax, right, these militants also collect the billions of the Pakistan rupees from basically Pakistan, right, due to this illegal excavation of the mining and the smuggling activities that are rampant between those militias between Afghanistan and Pakistan. And another region, maybe the Helmand is located on the Kabul-Herat National Highway. Okay, this Kabul-Herat National Highway, which connect the western provinces to the Kandahar and further to the Kabul. So they control the strategic Kabul-Herat National Highway also. And as you know that the famous narcotic smuggling hub, that is the Bairamcha, is also located in the southern hamland. So that is the famous for, you know, the narcotic smuggling for activities, and which are also connected with the Pakistan, Balochistan, and the Iran also. So these narcotics, or these, you know, this opium and other drugs have been smuggled to the Balochistan, in the Pakistan, to the Iran, and to further down also. Okay, and Taliban have the strong control over the Helmand, and they will be able to block, right, from these provinces, from, you know, from the western provinces, or even Kabul. So they want to have the strategic location, strategic control over there, right? And they, in that process, they basically used to accrue millions of the dollars of the funding through the opium or through other smuggling activities that they are getting out of it. Okay, and in terms of weather, the Helmand is also having some sort of a fairer weather, warm weather, right? Hardly 2 to 3 months of the mild winter, right, allow the insurgents to easily mobilize and conduct their operations, right? So without even need for the harsh weather outfits, right? And the most important crucial region the Taliban is interested is that in the Helmand provinces, there is a lack of security, education, infrastructure, both in education, medical, right, electricity, justice, employment, nothing is there. Okay, which caused, you know, the local citizens to grow dissatisfaction against the central government, against the government of Afghanistan. And now the Helmand become the battlefield, right? And its innocent citizens are basically paying a very, very high prices. They are losing their lives, they are looting their properties, they are losing their all resources. And, you know, this legacy of the pain has further agitated, you know, against the government. So Taliban take the advantage of these local grievances, okay, and manipulate those sentiments of these deprived citizens. And the Taliban is also in the process of recruiting those innocent citizens in their armed cadres, right? So that they could also fight along with them. And this is these are the major reasons. The Lashkar Gah basically serves a provincial capital for the Helmand. The Helmand River, I told you, that flows through the mainly desert region of the provinces, and there is also well developed the canal network system, right, out of this Helmand River. And this water is basically used for the drinking purpose as well as for the irrigation purpose. The famous Kazaki Dam is also located, right, basically in the Kazaki district in the Helmand provinces, is one of the Afghanistan's major reservoir for the purpose of supplying of the water for the drinking as well as for the irrigation purpose. Okay. And as I already informed you, that Helmand is one of the, you know, notorious provinces which are known for the largest opium producing regions in the world. Okay, the Helmand basically produces around 42% of the world total production of the opium, and that will be smuggled, and that will be illegally, you know, sent to the other areas of the world. And since 2001 war that was started, okay, The Helmand province has been the hotbed for the insurgent activities when the US-led NATO forces basically attacked, right? The Helmand province is to control, from the Taliban region, right? But they could not be succeed, right, to that extent. And hence it is considered Afghanistan's most dangerous provinces because of the higher and the greater control of the Taliban over this region. Okay, so here you could see the Helmand provinces, which is basically the southern province of the Afghanistan, and Kabul is the capital of Afghanistan, and the adjoining provinces is basically the Nimruz provinces, and it is also located to the border with the Pakistan also. Okay, that is also one of the reason that the Pakistan is also, you know, providing some sort of a strategic support to the Talibani fighters, specifically in the Helmand region also. Okay, next you have the doomsday scrolling. What is doomsday scrolling? The doomsday scrolling is basically a process, or simply is a surfing process, right, where we used to have our, you know, smartphones, tabs, or whatever we have, the laptops or whatever we have, and we are basically continuously just scrolling down the social media platforms, right? The social media news that is basically coming and flashing out in your mobile phones, in your laptops, in your, you know, tabs. And what we are looking at into that, in those, you know, the flashing out related news are basically the pandemic related news, right? And these are very, very painful, and most of us are basically finding ourselves to get stuck in that pandemic related news and, you know, the stories that are coming on the social media platforms. And that is basically exclusively what we are looking at, or what we are basically watching. So that is something called as doomsday scrolling. That is, wherever we scroll, we will just find out this pandemic related news on the social media platform. So that is something excessively what we are looking for, right? Or what we are finding in this social media platform. So doomsday surfing is basically refers to the tendency to continue to the surf or to scroll through the bad news, right? Even we know that this bad news is basically saddening or depressing for us. Okay. And many people are finding difficult to read those bad news because many people are not, you know, psychologically strong enough to get, you know, fit with those news, right? Because a lot of other news which are also related to the death and, you know, the chaos are also, you know, circulating around the social media platforms, right? So in that process, we are sacrificing our crucial sleep time, crucial working hours in that process, right? So that is what is something, you know, some of the drawback that is basically coming out of it. And but you must also understand that these news which are circulating on the social media through this doomsday scrolling process keeps ourselves updated. Okay, that also help us to mobilize some of the resources that may be, you know, used during certain cases of the, you know, pandemic time. And that is basically, you know, help us also to recover certain situations which may encounter in the future also. So that term is now gaining momentum, specifically nowadays, that we are basically, you know, we are having the tendency to continue to surf or to scroll through certain bad news, even though the news is saddening or depressing. We are concerning only with respect to the COVID related news, right? That's all we call them, the doomsday scrolling. Okay, next, placenta. Okay, the placenta, as you know, that placenta is basically you can say it's a key organ during the pregnancy. Okay, and whenever you have the pregnancy, it is the first organ that form. So why this placenta is in the news? The placenta is in the news because there were many studies which shows that the pregnant woman, right, or the lactating woman, right, they should not receive the COVID-19 vaccines because it may harm the placenta. And if the placenta is harmed, ultimately the fetus which are there will also be harmed, another, and ultimately the health of the mother will also get severely impacted. Okay, so but the new study which is published and which shows that the COVID-19 vaccine have no effect on the placenta, that means there is no evidence of injuring of this placenta, right, during the pregnancy. If you take even the COVID-19 vaccine, that means this study gives us the hope that the pregnant woman can now take the COVID-19 vaccines. Okay, they are safe, and there is no study which tell us that these vaccines are basically causing certain injury to the placenta. Okay, now let us understand a brief about the placenta. So placenta is a basically organ, Okay, it's a simple organ that develops in the uterus during the pregnancy. So this structure basically provides, you know, lot of the important things like the oxygen, nutrients to your growing baby, and they remove the waste products from your baby's blood also, right? So the placenta, which basically attached to the wall of the uterus, okay, the baby that is the wall of the uterus with the baby's, you know, the umbilical cord that is basically arising out of it. So it basically supply the oxygen and all sort of the things, nutrient to the baby. Okay, so the placenta is basically the large organ that develops during the pregnancy only. And as I told you that it is attached to the wall of your placenta uterus, right? Usually at the top or the side of the uterus. And this umbilical cord basically connect the placenta to the baby, and it passes, you know, lot of other things like filtering oxygen, glucose, nutrients to the baby, right, through this umbilical cord. Okay, so it performs various duties for the most of the foetus organs, right, while their organs are not yet developed. For example, it provides oxygen, right, while the lungs are not yet developed fully. It provides the nutrition when the gut is forming, right? So it basically provides lot of, you know, other supporting activities. And the placenta also manages the hormones and the immune systems, right, in the baby, and also tells the mother body to welcome the foetus and to nurture the foetus rather than to reject this foreign intruder, because it is the first time when you know, the mother is also feeling that something, you know, the foreign intruder is there in the basically in the uterus, and that basically acceptability of that is basically also been controlled by this placenta. Okay, so here you could see this cord, which is basically attached with, you know, you have the placenta, right, where, you know, umbilical cord is connected with the baby, and one side you are basically your uterus, that is the upper side or the lower side of your uterus. Okay, next, article 311. So article 311 basically provides certain safeguards to the civil servants, okay, from being dismissed from the service, right? And recently the article 311 is the news because the police officer Sachin Waze have been recently been dismissed from the job because of the, you know, the terrorist car case that is nearby Mukesh Ambani's house. Okay, now because of this terrorist car case, he was already suspended from the service. Now under article 311 clause 2 clause B, the Indian constitution provides certain safeguard to the police officer before being dismissed from the job. But he was ultimately dismissed by the Mumbai police commissioner under article 311 clause 2 clause B, but without departmental inquiry. That is the most cause of the concern why the departmental inquiry was not conducted in the case of Sachin Waze. Okay, now let us understand what is article 311 of the constitution provides the safeguard to the civil servants. So it says that article 311 says that no civil servants, right, or All India Service officer or any state government officer shall be dismissed or removed from the service, right, without any authority or by any authority which is subordinate to the authority who appointed them. That means such officer or such All India servant or any other state government employee cannot be dismissed, cannot be removed from the service other than the authority, right, which is subordinate to the authority which appointed those servants. The first safeguard is this. Okay, then section 2 basically provides that any such officer which is going to be suspended, which is going to be dismissed, which is going to be removed from the service, or which is going to be, you know, reduction in their rank, right, any such officer can be removed from the service, can be dismissed from the service, or can be reduced in the rank, but a reasonable opportunity for the inquiry, right, it should be provided. That means an inquiry for that purpose should be conducted, right, and the concerned officer should be informed about the charges, and the concerned officer should be given the reasonable opportunity, right, of, you know, of basically, you know, with respect to those charges which are against the concerned officer, so that he could also, you know give some evidence or give some clue and in the support of his case, right? So a reasonable inquiry, reasonable time, reasonable charges, right, all such things can be given to the concerned police officer during the process. Now this departmental inquiry that we are concerning, right, that departmental inquiry generally done by the department at the department level, and an inquiry officer for that purpose is appointed. Okay, and the civil servant is given a significant amount of the time to represent its case, right? And in that case, the formal charge sheet, right, of the charges against that concerned officer is being presented to the inquiry officer. Okay, and in that case, the civil servant can represent himself, right? And or he can also choose a lawyer for that purpose. He can defend his charges, right, whatever the charges have been put against the officer. And at the last, right, he can also call the witness, right, during the departmental inquiry. And at the last, the inquiry officer, which is being appointed by the department, would submit a report or would prepare a report, and that report will be submitted to the department or to the government ultimately for further action. And based on that report, which is submitted by the inquiry officer, the government will take further action. Okay. Now, there are certain exceptions also that this departmental inquiry is not necessary, right? And what are those exceptions when the departmental inquiry is not needed? For example, if the government employee is convicted in the criminal cases, so conviction is needed. Conviction means the court has pronounced guilty. The court has pronounced guilty that the concerned officer is convicted in certain criminal offense. Now it should be the criminal offense only, and so that he can dismiss in that case even without departmental inquiry also. Second, if the president or the governor, president in the case of the All India Services, right, or the Central Civil Services, or governor in the case of the State Civil Services or the State Services, right, if the president or the governor, right, is satisfied that the concern officers, you know, dismissal from the service or removal from the service is in the best interest of the security of the state, right, and if the president and the governor basically satisfied themselves that it is not expedient to hold such a departmental inquiry, and even without departmental inquiry, okay, the dismissal or the removal of the officer is in the best interest of the security of the state, the president and the governor can do so, can basically remove the officer, can dismiss the officer, or can lower the rank of the officer even without a departmental inquiry. So that is Article 311 clause 2 clause C. Like this provides, you know, direct dismissal, direct removal, or reduction of the rank even without departmental inquiry. All right. Next you have the Vichcombe Metroid, right? So first of all, the Vichcombe is basically a county. Sorry, the Vichcombe Metroid is basically a meteorite which have been named by the scientist. Now, this Vichcombe Metroid have been touched down or have been found in the town of the Vichcombe in Gloucesterry, right, which is basically a county. So this Gloucesterryshire is a county in the southwest England. The county comprises, you know, the Cotswold Hills and part of the flat fertile valley of the River Severn, and you have the entire forest area also. So the town of the Vichcombe, where the Vichcombe meteorite have been recently been found or recently been touched down, right, and it has been found in the February 2021. Now this meteorite have been put in the National History Museum. Now let us understand what is this meteorite, what is this meteors, and what is this meteorite, right, what we are talking about. So first of all, sometime what happens is that, you know, the asteroids, okay, these asteroids can smash together or they can collide together, and this collision basically causes small pieces of the asteroids to break off, right? These small pieces, we call them basically the meteoroids. The small pieces, we call them meteoroids, right? Now these meteoroids can come from the comets also, sometime from the comets also. Now these asteroids are basically smaller than the planet, that you must understand, but they are larger than the pebble size objects. We call them the meteoroids, okay? And these asteroids are found in our solar system. They are found in the main asteroid belt, which are found in the Mars, between the Mars and the Jupiter. Okay, these meteoroids comes close enough to the Earth. Okay, whenever these meteoroids come closer to the Earth, right, they enter in our Earth's atmospheric system. Okay, and they basically vaporize and turn into the meteor. So meteors are basically those meteoroids which enter in our solar system, but they basically vaporize. Okay, they are called meteor, and they form the streak of the light in the sky. Okay, because of their appearance, these streaks of the light are sometimes also called the shooting stars. But the meteors are not actually the stars. You know probably that. Okay, because the meteors have the streak of the light in the sky, right? And they are sometimes confused with the comets also, right? But there are certain difference between the comets and those shooting stars also. Like comets, you know, the comets basically orbits around the sun just like asteroids. Okay, and but you must understand that comets are basically made up of ice and the dust. The asteroids are basically made up of the rock, but the comets are made up of ice and the dust, right? And the other important difference between the comet and the asteroids are that the comets basically, you know, they orbit, you know, towards the sun, right? And the ice and dust begin to vaporize during the process. The vaporized ice and the dust become the comet's tail, that you would have seen also, the tail of the comet. Okay, now you can see even the comet even when it is far from the earth. Okay, but when you see a comet, right, or what you see a meteor in our solar, in our atmosphere, that looks a bit different than the comet. Okay, so what is the meteorite is all about? The meteorites are sometime, you know they don't vaporize completely in the atmosphere, because in fact they survive their trip during the earth atmosphere, and they land on the surface of the earth. When they land on the surface of the earth, they are called meteorites. Okay, and the meteorites, when enter into the earth atmosphere with a very high speed, they burn up just like a fireballs or the shooting star. They are called meteors. But when this meteorite basically survive a trip through the atmosphere and hitting the ground, it is known as meteorite. So this is what is the difference between the meteors, meteorites, comets, asteroids. I've told you everything here in the basics here itself, right? So how this meteorites was discovered, right? It was discovered when 103 grams of the fragment of the black rock, right, which have almost resembled to the coal, have been found, right? Basically, in, you know, from the, you know, have been found by the scientists from the University of the Glasgow, right? And this meteorite basically landed in the driveway of a house which is located here, the county of the Gloucestershire, right, in the February, and considered the astonishing rare, right, which is the sign of that it is basically meteorite which has been survived this, you know, the trip that through the atmosphere, and that basically hit the ground, and that is weighing around 103 grams of the fragment. Right. So here we have found this meteorite. Okay, next you have the common crane, right? The common crane is just like a crane, right? It is basically bird, it is a mammal, right? This common crane are once found in the Ireland. Okay, now this was disappeared from the Ireland three centuries back, but it has now been reappeared. Okay, now the crane is basically a part of the folklore and is basically a popular pet during the medieval times, but it has now been returned to the island nation. Now it has been spotted after three centuries. Now, so prior to, you know, the pair of the cranes that was spotted last year, right, on the peat bog, right, which is a type of wetland which is found in the northern latitude of the countries, right? So where this common crane have been reappeared, and the word generally resides in the island's midland region, right? But their exact location have been kept secret by the island itself, because the island, there is some problems related to the illegal poaching, illegal killing of this common crane. So this exact position were there basically kept secret, but they are generally found in the midland region of the island. Okay, and this crane or this common crane is basically, you know, a 4 feet tall, and you know, it's having the wingspan of around 7 feet long. So you can think of the size of the crane, right? The height or the tallness of that crane is 4 feet. The wingspan is 7 feet. 7 feet, just like a size of the human, or more than the size of the human. It is also the largest bird in the island, right? And they were very, very common once their habitats have been destroyed by the humans itself, because of the developmental activities, because of the industrial development, because of the colonial development, right, what happens is they were disappeared since 16th and the 7th centuries onward. Okay, so what we are talking here, the island, what is island? Island is basically an island in the North Atlantic. In the North Atlantic, you can see the map of the island. This is what we are talking about, the common crate, right, which has been found in the island. So island is basically, an island in the Northern Atlantic. It is separated from the Great Britain, right, to the east by the Northern Channel, the Irish Sea and St. George Channel. Right, you could see easily find out in the physical map of the world. And the island is basically the second largest island in the British Isles, and is the third largest island in the Europe. In the Europe, and is the 20th largest island on the earth also. Okay. Next, the Ranjana Nirula. Ranjana Nirula was basically an activist. Okay, she was also the working committee member and the former treasurer of the Center of Indian Trade Unions. She recently died of the COVID-19 related complications, and she was also suffering from the Crohn's disease. She died at the age of 75. Okay, so the news about the activist Ranjana Nirula is basically coming, right? So she was basically, the introduce to the left movement as a student when she was basically studying in the college, okay, in the United States. And she was active in the anti-Vietnam War movement also at that point of the time. She came back to India in early 1970s and joined the left movement here. That means she was associated with the Marxist, ideology, or with the leftist ideology. Okay, regarding the Center of Indian Trade Union, see, Center of the Indian Trade Unions is a national labor trade union in the India. And it's a trade union wing, and it is spearheaded by the Indian Trade Union movement. Okay, the Center of Indian Trade Unions is today one of the biggest assembly of workers and the classes of India. Okay, and I was also telling you that Ranjana Nirula was also suffering from the Crohn's disease. What is the Crohn's disease? See, Crohn's disease is basically a type of inflammatory bowel disease. Okay, this inflammatory bowel disease or the Crohn's disease basically causes the inflammation in your digestive tract, and it can lead to the abdominal pain and severe diarrhea, fatigue, weight loss, and other malnutrition related, the symptoms. And this inflammation which is caused by this Crohn's disease can involve, different areas of the digestive tract in the different people, right? So that's all about the Crohn's disease. And she become the full member of, the Center for the Indian Trade Union in 1978 when she returned. Okay, and she was one of the founders of All India Democratic Women's Association in Delhi. The All India Women's Democratic Association was also associated with the Communist Party, right? It is also having the leftist ideology. So All India Democratic Women's Association is a women's organization which is committed to achieving the democracy, the equality, the women's emancipation, right? And it has the organizational presence in almost 23 states in India. Okay, and the currently membership of the women in this All India Democratic Women's Association is around 9 million, you could think of, and it is associated with the Communist Party of India, or it's having the leftist ideology. And Miss Ranjana Nirula was also working as the editor of the journal which is titled as The Voice of the Working Woman. And in 2009, the Center for Indian the Trade Union formed the All India Coordination Committee of the ASHA Workers, and she was become the first convener of this, the Coordination Committee of the ASHA Workers for that purpose. So she was Miss Ranjana Nirula. She was 75 years of the age, and she recently died of the COVID complication as well as the Crohn's disease complications, right? All right. Next, the lightning and animal deaths. Now you must understand the lightning. The lightning is a natural process, right, through which the light got struck on the surface of the earth, right, during the thunderstorms, during the raining time, or during the cyclones. So it has been reported that in the hilltop in the Assam state of India, almost 18 elephants are died because of the lightning. Okay, the post-mortem report says that they all got died because of the lightning. Okay, now let us understand how the lightnings kill the animals. The lightnings are nowadays becoming a major problem, right? Specifically for the deaths of those bigger animals like elephants. So lightning basically causes the death of those bigger animals in the different ways, right? First, the direct flash, right? For example, if the animal is there in the open field, right, and suddenly the light got stuck directly, right? If any part of the body, right, which is basically protruding over another object in the vicinity, and light got stuck on that particular object, right, the taller animals or the bigger animals which are basically comes into contact with that object, and suddenly the animal died in the process. The side flash. In the side flash, what happens is any taller object, if where the animal is founding or animal is standing or just sitting or lying over there, just like a big tree you can think of, right? So whenever the light got stuck on this big tree, what happens is it generates a very, very high flash, specifically the side flash. And the animal which is basically standing, you know, or lying down under this big tree can also comes into the, you know, basically in the contact with that side flash, and animal died instantly. Next, you have the touch potential. Touch potential means if the any part of the animal body, if they are coming the contact with the ground, touch, very simple touch. So any part, if they are coming into the contact with the ground, right, while other part which are at the higher elevation, right, come into contact with the light which struck the object, okay, that basically flows some sort of a current, and that current basically passed through the body of, you know, the animal, and animal instantly died in the process. And the next is step potential. In the step potential, it is the most common hazard, specifically for those animals who basically runs on the four legs, right? So whenever the animal front and front two legs and the heat two legs or heat two feet, right, they are far enough, right, this current may pass through the body in certain circumstances, and that basically causes the steep potential, and that causes the death of the animal. So here the animals, you can see these animals basically died because of the lightning. Okay, next you have the Urbi. Urbi was basically a tunnel boring machine, right? The Urbi, which is a tunnel boring machine, have been completed, right, its work, right, at the War Bazaar, Kolkata, on 15th of the May 2021. So it completed the work of the metro or east-west metro corridor in the Kolkata. So with that breakthrough of entire tunnel boring machine, right, for the Kolkata east-west metro project is now completed with respect to the boring of these tunnels. Okay, the tunnel boring machine, which is also known as Urbi, has earlier completed, you know, the eastbound tunnel from the, you know, Esplanade to the Sialdah on 9th of October 2020. Okay, and again it was relaunched from the Sialdah, right, because this stretch was not completed. It was again relaunched after some inspection or refurbishment, and because of 800 meters of the tunneling was still remaining, that was completed on the 15th May this year. And the best bound tunnel from the Sialdah to the War Bazaar was completed. The eastbound tunnel was already completed before, that was from the Sialdah to Esplanade, right? Now from Sialdah to the War Bazaar was basically completed, that was the best bound tunnel. So you can think of the Sialdah is basically, you know, the middle, the station from the best bound tunnel. Yes, that is War Bazaar, right? Yeah. And that is Sialdah, and the eastbound tunnel, that is Sialdah from Esplanade, that was long back, that was completed, and now this stretch was also completed by this tunnel boring machine also. So here you have the pictorial depiction of the tunnel boring machine. So you just read 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, that is the sequential work that has been done or that has been carried out by the tunnel boring machine. So first of all, you have the grippers. That grippers basically take the grip of the rock or the rock surface. This rock, after coming to contact these grippers, they have some sort of alloy steel disc, right, which is basically connected with the cutter head. This cutter head basically cut down these rocks, right, crush down these rocks, right, and these crushed rocks basically scooped and further, you know, conveyor belt is also there. This conveyor belt, okay, this conveyor belt basically, you know, takes this the crushed rock basically from the front side of this tunnel boring machine to the back side of this tunnel boring machine. Here you could see this is basically, you know, the belt where you could easily see this this crushed rock which is being carried from the top to the back side of your tunnel boring machine, which is being removed over the period of the time. Then see the fourth, that is the concrete ring. These are the concrete rings which are basically the precast segments of the concrete ring. These concrete rings are basically loaded on this platform. Now these rings, when reaches to the certain location over there, right, these rings were basically, you know, brought together by using the special vacuum lifting device, right? So that special vacuum lifting device, these rings come together in the form of, you know, a circle, and then these rings basically, you know, assembled together and then put in the close proximity to the previous ring, right? And after putting the close proximity to the previous ring, there is obviously a gap between these two rings. This gap between the two rings are filled, right, with a grout. That is basically, this grout is basically made up of the concrete and other, you know, some of the ingredients to stop the water coming out from the tunnel, right, specifically during this construction phase or after construction phase. And ultimately the machine moves forward 1.7 meters every time, and that process again start again. So every time 1.7 meters crushing down, scooping down those material, right, bringing that material to the back of the, you know, tunnel boring machine. And then you have, you know, the concrete segment that will be pushed through you know, a platform, and then they will be having, you know, the concrete rings that are built in that process. And again these concrete rings are basically put into the segment through a lifting device. These concrete rings are basically placed nearby with the previous ring, and the gap between these rings are filled by the grout so that the water do not come out. And in that process, every time the tunnel boring machine moves 1.7 meters ahead. And that is how this tunnel boring machine basically bored the tunnels. Next, you have M.S. Narasimhan. M.S. Narasimhan was basically an Indian mathematician who was recently died. Prime Minister Narendra Modi have expressed a grief over the demise of the professor M.S. Narasimhan. He was born in 1932, and he died in 2021. Okay. The professor M.S. Narasimhan, also known as, right, the great mathematician, the professor M.S. Narasimhan, along with the C.S. Seshadri, right, they both worked, right, as a theorem that is known as the Narasimhan-Seshadri theorem, right, and in which they have proved that the holomorphic vector bundle over the Riemann surface is stable if and only if it comes from the irreducible projective unitary representation of the fundamental group. That is, some of the theorems belongs to the core mathematics. Okay, you need not to worry about it, but you must remember this theorem, that is Narasimhan-Seshadri theorem, okay, which is also the most important theorem specifically in the vector. Okay, and Professor M.S. Narasimhan also headed the research group in the mathematics at the International Center for the Theoretical Physics in Trieste, which is located in the Italy. Okay, now what is this international the Center for Theoretical Physics, right? It is also known as the Abdus Salam International Center for the Theoretical Physics. It is basically established in 1964 by late Nobel laureate Abdus Salam. Okay, so this ICTP International Center for Theoretical Physics seeks to accomplish its mandate by providing scientists from the developing countries with the continuing education and the skills that they need to enjoy the long and the productive careers. So ICTP basically have been a major force in the stemming of the scientific brain drain from the developing world. And M.S. Narasimhan was also honorary fellow at the Tata Institute for the Fundamental Research. The Tata Institute of the Fundamental Research is a public deemed research university which is located in the Mumbai. Okay, and it is dedicated to the basic research in the mathematics and the sciences. And you can also say that it is a deemed university, works under the umbrella of the Department of Atomic Energy, Government of India. All right, so he was M.S. Narasimhan, who was the greater mathematician who recently died because of the COVID-19 complications. All right. Fine. So that's all for today. So thank you for watching this video. We will meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Take care of yourself and be safe, be at home. We'll meet again tomorrow. Thank you.